presence of the Lord, the Holy One is here. Be still, for the glory of the Lord is shining all around. He burns with holy fire, with splendor he is crowned.
On this Pentecost Sunday, Communion Sunday, and General Assembly Sunday. So Pentecost marks the official end of the season of Easter. It takes place 50 days after Easter Sunday. In fact, Pentecost is Greek for the number 50. This day celebrates the story of the winds and the flames of the Spirit, the winds and the flames of change that swept through the apostles and other followers of Jesus while they were gathered in Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Weeks, as described in the book of Acts. And we're going to be hearing a little bit from that book later in our service. So it seems rather appropriate that on this Sunday that commemorates change, we made a change in our seating pattern here at Knox. We find that as we go forward post-COVID and with recording our services for online, we do have to keep doing some tweaks and changes along the way. We've decided or discovered that in order to get the best angle for our online services, the camera really does have to be in the middle of the sanctuary so things aren't off kilter. But when the sanctuary is set up with a center aisle, that can make for some awkward moments if people need to leave the service for whatever reason, to visit the nursery, to visit the facilities, and they have to walk right down that center aisle, walking right into the line of sight of the video camera. I was saying it's almost like if anybody remembers Second City 3D House of Horrors, and you're like going close to the camera and back. And it can be a little bit awkward and off-putting. So as they are trying to leave the service unnoticed, usually, they're on full display for the at-home congregation. So a few of us spoke about this dilemma last week after the church service, and someone mentioned that instead of moving the camera, why don't we move the people? And so that's why we have come up with this seating arrangement, so that we could facilitate coming and going, because we want people to feel free to come and go during the worship service, but we want to make that as smoothly as possible. So it makes it a bit easier if you're heading out down this aisle, no problem at all, you just head right down and out that door. But if you're heading down this aisle, it's probably best, if you don't want to be noticed, that you head down the aisle and then go behind the camera and right to the back room there, and then head out from there. And then that way you can come and go as often as you want, and you won't be noticed or picked up by the online congregation. And then this also serves another purpose, especially for us this morning as we celebrate the sacrament of communion. We'll be directing you to come up this aisle and then just process through and receive your communion elements. Again, we're following a COVID-friendly format for communion, so you pick up your bread, your juice, you partake while you're here, and then just drop your empty glass of juice in those empty trays there, and then you can process back down that aisle and back to your seating. Now, the beauty of our worship space here at Knox is its flexibility. We are able to make these changes on the fly. And so if we find that this really doesn't work for us, maybe it was a good theory, but it doesn't play out practically very well, then we can just switch it back or we can try something new. So we'd like to hear what you think about this change too, and hopefully it will make for a smooth service online and in person. So as I mentioned, it is Pentecost Sunday, it is Communion Sunday, and it is General Assembly Sunday. So General Assembly is the highest court of our denomination, and it meets once a year during the first full week of June. For the only time in history it didn't meet during COVID. And so that was one time when the moderator ended up serving for 2 years. But normally there is a moderator that is elected for the 1 year appointment. So assembly will commence this afternoon at 2 o'clock with a worship service. And we are so fortunate that one of our elders, Ann Foreman, is attending General Assembly as a commissioner this year on behalf of the Presbytery of Barrie. So the proceedings are going to take place online again this year, as they have since COVID began, once we resumed after COVID. And so Anne will be following along, and then as a commissioner, she will also be able to vote on all of the overtures and the remits, the recommendations that come forward. And if you are a General Assembly geek like I am, you're able to follow along in real time, as all of the proceedings will be live streamed through the Presbyterian Church in Canada's YouTube channel. Well, our prayers are with Anne as she participates in this most important aspect of our denomination's governance. And just a few other announcements to share with you. One of them is somebody among us has a birthday today that ends in a 0 and a 5, or a 5. This one ends in a 5, and so we wish happy birthday to Alex Malcolm, who I won't say the number, but it does end in a 5, and he is the chair of our board of managers. So our best wishes are with you, Alex, on this day. And the scrap metal bin will be there for one more day, is that correct, Dan? One or two. So Monday or Tuesday it will be gone and the fundraiser will be completed. So thank you to all of you who have contributed to it. And if you were thinking, I have some scrap metal that I have to drop off there, it better be today or tomorrow, I think, because it could be gone. But it's been a wonderful response again so far, and all the funds raised go to our refugee partnership with the United Church. Paul, our organist, is visiting with his mom in the States. So today, all of our music will be on video, and next Sunday, Kate Ward will be with us to lead our music. Also next Sunday, the pulpit will be filled by Reverend Dr. Rick Horst, as I will be away, as I've been asked to participate in a special mortgage burning service at Living Faith Presbyterian Church in Baxter, and Rick will be filling in for me here. I think he's going to be shocked when he walks in, because he hasn't been here since he served as our interim moderator before me. So I'm going to give him a warning so that he knows where to go and what to do. And I know he's really looking forward to spending this time with you, as I'm sure you will with him as well. And we're thankful for him. And just one more announcement, which sort of came out of the blue this week. I received a call from Susan Reed from Bracebridge. And Susan and her husband, George, are actually hosting 2 refugees from Ukraine. They arrived on May 14th. They are a 19 and 20-year-old couple, Dan Blokin and Lisa Ermoshenko. And they arrived with the suitcases in their hands and nothing else. So Susan and George have been wonderful providing them with housing, helping them to get acclimated, getting their documents in place. But one thing she said they could use are clothing items and toiletries. So a woman's small, she said, a man's large. If you'd like to talk to me about that after the service, I can get you more of the details. But that's one way that we can help refugees who are here right now from Ukraine and be able to put our faith into action for them. Well, we're going to join together now for the call to worship. And I will read the words in plain font, and you're invited to respond with the words in bold. Even after that first Easter, when the disciples were weighed down with worry, Jesus assured them that they were not alone. The Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and will remind you of all I have said to you. Even after that first Easter, when the disciples were burdened by their fears, Jesus calmed their troubled hearts. There we go. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. Even after the season of Easter, when we struggle with our faith, Jesus blesses us with comfort and hope. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Especially after the season of Easter, when our souls are dry and barren, the Holy Spirit blows through our lives, bringing us new life. Alleluia. Please join with me in prayer, which will be followed by the Lord's Prayer in unison. Let's pray together. God of wind and fire, God of change and renewal, God of stability and constancy, you call us today just as you called the disciples on the day of Pentecost, challenging and supporting us, renewing and refreshing us, revealing the brokenness around us, while offering us the peace that our world needs. Show us the elements of our church, our community, and ourselves that are in need of the winds and flames of change. And then give us the courage and strength to make those changes happen, knowing that we are being guided by your Spirit. Just as your Spirit has been at work throughout the ages, bringing renewal and hope to a people in need, send the winds of renewal and the flames of passion to your people yet again, so we may respond to the needs around us in ways that are helpful and hopeful. And we ask thus, uniting our voices together with the prayer Jesus taught, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And we'll now remain seated as we sing together, Shine.
Lord, the light of your love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us, set us free by the truth you now bring us. gaze on your kingly brightness, so our faces display your likeness, ever changing from glory to glory. Mirrored here, may our lives tell your story. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine.
A couple things to show you this morning. One of them, I've got two now, is a pinwheel. Have you seen these things around? So if I just hold it up like this, it's pretty, it's a nice little flower, but it's not at its full potential. It can do so much more, and let's hope I can do it. I don't have a lot of wind. There it goes. So if I blow on it, oh, it's going the other way. I think I have to be blowing in the right direction. Or if we put them outside in the gardens, which we will put some of these outside in the gardens later. Well, I'm a little lightheaded after doing that. It shows its full potential. It'll do more. It'll spin much better when it has some wind power behind it. Well, I have something else here, too, that does so much better with something behind it. It lives up to its potential when we give it a little bit of help. And you probably know what these are. So if I just held this up here like this, it would be a bit of a drippy mess, but with wind behind it, that I can do. It's so much more exciting and pretty, and I could do that all day, so I better stop. And then we also have some balloons up here. They're sort of the color of flames too, for Pentecost, the wind and flame of Pentecost. These balloons would not look as pretty as they are if they hadn't been blown up with wind and actually with helium as well, these ones, so that they'll float. So they live up to their full potential. They are beautiful. They are doing what they've been created to do when they are filled with some power. And in this case, the power is from wind. Well, I like to think that God is like that wind. We can't see it, but we can see the results of it. So when I was blowing the pinwheel, or when I was blowing through to the bubbles, you couldn't see my breath. Hopefully it wasn't green looking. You couldn't see my breath going through, but you could see the results of the wind that I generated. And God's Spirit is like that. We can't actually see it, but we can see the results of it. And God's Spirit is visible whenever we act with justice, love, and peace. Whenever we care for one another, whenever we share what we have with another person, when we look out for others, those on the schoolyard, those in our community who might be forgotten or ignored by others, that's when God's Spirit is at work. So God's Spirit is that thing that we can't see, but that motivates us to take care of one another. So even though we can't see God's Spirit, we can definitely see the results of it. So whenever you feel prompted to help one another, whenever you feel urged to share what you have with others, I would encourage you to go ahead and do it. If it is a good thing, go ahead and do it, because then you will be putting God's Spirit into action. And it's that action that can be seen and received by others. Just like the spinning pinwheel, the floating bubbles, and the beautiful balloons. It's God's Spirit that prompts us, that urges us to live up to our full potential and to help others live up to theirs. Well, let's join together now in prayer, and then after our prayer, you'll be heading out to Sunday school, but you're able to take the bubbles and the pinwheels with you as you go out to Sunday school. Let's pray together. God, thank you for your Spirit, which prompts us to act with love and compassion for others. Whenever we feel prompted to care for others, give us the courage to do it. Then we will be making your Spirit visible to others. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. You guys can head out for Sunday school now.
With the Spirit early in the morning, walk with the Spirit throughout the long day. Work and hope for the new life upon, and listen to the Spirit to show you the way.
Dance with the Spirit early in the morning, walk with the Spirit throughout the long day. Work and hope for the new life upon, and listen to the Spirit to show you the way. Dance with the
Acts 2, 1-21. When the day of the Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, sounds like the blowing of a violent wind came from the heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that had separated and come to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now, they were sitting in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. Where they heard the sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each of them heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes, Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia, Phrygia, Pamphylia, Egypt, parts of Libya, near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews converted to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of the God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked to another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said they have had too much wine. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, addressed the crowd. Fellow Jews and all who have listened in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk as you suppose. It is only 9 a.m. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour my spirit out on people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below. Blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before coming of the great glorious day of the Lord, and anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. John 14:8-17. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip, even after I've been among you for such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe I am the Father, and that the Father is in me? The words I say do not speak on my own authority, rather it is the Father living in me who is doing the work. Believe in me when I say that I am the Father, and the Father is in me. Or at least, believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. If you love me, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you an advocate to help you and be with you forever. John 14:25-27. All of this I have spoken while still with you, but the Advocate of the Holy Spirit, whom the Father sends in my name, will teach you things and remind you of everything I have said to you. Peace I leave with you, and my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid.
Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God. Well, last Sunday afternoon, I attended a special worship service at Hillsdale Presbyterian Church, which was hosted by the Presbytery of Barrie. I say this was a special worship service because it was held to commemorate the closing of this congregation. After 171 years of serving the community of Hillsdale, the time had come for the congregation to close. They were tired. Their building requires lots of maintenance. The number of people attending on Sundays could be counted on one hand, and it was simply time to celebrate the ministry that had been and then to let it graciously come to a close. And that is what we did last Sunday afternoon. As I sat in the sanctuary during that service last Sunday afternoon, I thought about all of the people over the past 171 years who had sat in that same place. All of the weddings, baptisms, funerals, professions of faith, sermons, hymns, potluck suppers, all sorts of celebrations that had been held throughout the decades in that space. I also thought about all the other services just like that one that I've attended in the past 22 years that I have been part of the Presbytery of Barrie. And if my math and my memory are correct, we have seen at least 9 churches close in our presbytery during that time frame. Now, we could lament those closures. We could conduct a post-mortem and analyze what led to their demise. And we could wring our hands and worry about which one is going to be next, which is exactly what I was doing during much of that time last Sunday afternoon. But I happened upon an article just a few days ago which challenged me to re-examine my line of thinking. that forced me to see these church closures not as events to lament and grieve, even though I did a lot of lamenting and grieving. Last Sunday afternoon, I told Elaine it was a two Kleenex service. But instead, to see these events as a movement of God's Spirit, which can lead to renewal and revitalization. So the article that I happened upon reminded me that many of our church buildings were constructed in a time which simply doesn't exist anymore. Multiple churches dotted the landscape decades ago because people were not as mobile as we are today. Almost every village and small town, and of course the big cities, had its own church, often at least two or three churches representing different denominations, because folks wanted to and they needed to worship in their own communities. Not every family had a vehicle like we do today, so churches had to be within walking distance or horseback riding distance. Also, there was fierce denominational loyalty when many of our older churches were constructed. So all of the major denominations needed to be represented. If you were Presbyterian, you didn't dare attend the Anglican Church. Or if you were Baptist, you didn't step foot into the United Church. But that world doesn't exist anymore. Denominational loyalty isn't a priority. People are more likely to attend a church where they feel welcome, where they fit in, and where they connect with the teachings and the people. So church location isn't as important as it once was. Many families have more than one vehicle and don't think twice about traveling out of their community to go to church. And denominational loyalty isn't as it once was. We go where we feel welcomed and accepted. So the article explained that church closures, those closings that we're seeing today, are a response to these changing conditions. And instead of being something to lament and grieve, these closings should be celebrated and exemplified as a faithful response to the moving of God's Spirit. I had a hard time accepting that, and I've mulled over the contents of that article for these past few days. And I think its explanation should come with a disclaimer. It's one thing to close a church building. It's quite another thing to stop being the church. If there's one thing we've learned during the pandemic, it is that the church is not confined to a building. We have discovered that we can be church on Zoom, on YouTube, gathered as a people in a park around a picnic table, on somebody's back deck, or in a coffee shop. We can be the church while serving others through the Out of the Cold program, while gardening alongside others in our community gardens. This is not the church. This is the church. But when this closes, without this finding a way to continue being the church, then I think that truly is something to lament and grieve. When the people had gathered in Jerusalem to celebrate the Feast of Weeks, they were discovering how to be the church. We read in the book of Acts that Will read for us this morning that people had come from all over the known world, each one of them speaking their own native language. Some of those people who had gathered followed the traditional Jewish practices, while others wondered how to integrate the teachings of Jesus into this fresh understanding of faith. So something new was needed. The old way of doing things just didn't fit anymore. That world didn't exist anymore. And so into this new landscape, God's Spirit appeared as wind and flame, bringing with it renewal and revitalization, a new way of doing things. Those who had gathered were able to hear the wonders of God, as it's described in verse 11, in their own languages, which then made it possible for them to take this message to their own countries and to share this message in their own languages. They heard Peter recite the words of the prophet Joel, "I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even my servants, on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy." And from that first Pentecost forward, they have lived out that prophecy. Fanned by the winds and the flames of the Spirit, the teachings of Jesus spread, and they were shared in every known country, in every known land, and in every known language at that time. And eventually, buildings were constructed. Buildings were constructed to house this movement of the Spirit, to provide a home for the Spirit to reside and to be made visible, to be lived out through the people. People filled with God's Holy Spirit. People who became the church. But this movement of change resided in the people. People filled with the Spirit. And those Spirit-filled people gathered in buildings, yes, but they were not confined, and the Spirit was not confined to the building. And over the years, some of those buildings closed. Services were held, like the one I attended last Sunday afternoon. But those Spirit-filled people lived on, discovering new ways to continue being the church. So some of those Spirit-filled people amalgamated their congregations with another to create a new way of being the church. Some of those Spirit-filled people realized that their former buildings were no longer accessible or didn't meet the needs, the changing needs of their communities. So they found new locations and new ways of being the church. And that probably sounds familiar to many of us here at Knox, because that's exactly what you've done. And still others of those Spirit-filled people discovered that they could be more effective at sharing that Spirit without a building at all. So they gathered in homes, in storefronts, in coffee shops. The Spirit lived on, even if the building didn't. Now, we will likely see more church buildings close, and we will likely attend more services like the one I attended last Sunday afternoon. But I'm reminded that just because the building closes, the church doesn't. God's Spirit lives on in new creative ways and in new creative places. However, on this Pentecost Sunday, I must admit that I am so thankful for the gift of this church home. This flexible church home that allows us to change things up on the fly, that allows us to gather, to serve, to feed, to care, and to make God's Spirit visible. But I pray that we as a congregation, and also we as individuals, as we face changes in our own lives, would always be open to the winds of renewal and the flames of passion that are not confined to this space, but that in fact reside within each one of us, allowing us to be the church beyond these walls, allowing us to make God's Spirit visible wherever we may be. Amen.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at his table. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. And I won't hunger anymore at his table. Come all you weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, his burden.
God's Pentecostal spirit of compassion and grace is present here in this space, in these gifts of bread and wine, and within each one of us. Here we are renewed and refreshed. Here we are welcomed and accepted. For this is the table of grace. This is the table where every person is invited. For this is not my table. This is not your table. It's not Knox's table. It's not the Presbyterian Church in Canada's table. This is Christ's table. And at this table, there is space enough for everyone. I just, before we get going, want to tell you a little story from last Sunday afternoon's worship service at Hillsdale Presbyterian Church. During that service, we held communion. And behind me sat a very elderly gentleman. I'm not quite sure what his connection to the church had been. He had obviously not been in some time. He didn't really seem to be familiar with what was going on with the service. But when the moderator of the presbytery lifted up the bread of communion, and she held it high over her head like this, he went, "Oh, look at that." So may we come to the table this morning with that type of joy and glee and wonder. Look at that. Look what God's Spirit has done and is doing in this place. Well, as we prepare to come to this table, I invite you to join with me for the great prayer of thanksgiving, which should be on a little page on your chair. And we will recite this prayer together. God's Spirit is with us. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. God, whose Spirit appears as winds of renewal and flames of passion, as you have revitalized your church throughout the ages, re-energize us today. We reflect upon the way your winds and flames have transformed your people since the dawn of time. You led your children out of slavery and into freedom. You spoke through prophets to challenge corruption and greed. New birth for creation broke forth upon us in Jesus. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. In these acts of love and justice, we see the birth of our call as the church. And so we rejoice with all your people of every time and place, saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. It is Jesus, the essence of love and unity, who joins us together as a community of broken but hopeful people, loving what he loved, living what he taught, and striving to be his faithful servants in our time and place. In this meal, we remember Jesus, his promises, his servant leadership, and his abiding love. We remember how on the night before Jesus died, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and said, Take and eat. Whenever you do this, remember me. After supper, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks for it, poured, and said, This is the new covenant. Whenever you drink of it, remember me. We do remember. We remember his life of love, his friendship, his teaching, his dying, and his rising to life again. God of love, Spirit of compassion, bless us in this bread and wine, that they would unite us with you, with one another, and with your children in all the world. Open us to the movement of the winds and flames of your Holy Spirit, allowing us to be the church in creative ways for a changing world. And we receive Jesus' promised gift of an advocate who would be with us forever, granting us peace not as the world gives, but peace that surpasses all understanding. Through Christ, in Christ, and with Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, God of grace, now and forever. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Come, taste and see that the Lord is good.
for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation. We remember you. divine for any to receive. By your mercy we come to your table. By your grace you are making us faithful. Lord, we us to worship, and as we worship you, our worship leads to communion. We respond to your invitation, we remember you.
Having fed us with these gifts of grace and love, prepare us, God, now to go out into your world to share this love with others. Fill us with the winds of renewal and the flames of passion so that we would be your church in creative ways for a changing world. Open us to the call of your Spirit to respond to the many needs that are around us. Prompt us to use our resources to feed a hungry world, to bring peace to a warring people, and to share love with all who are lonely. We pray that your Spirit of renewal would guide our church, especially as our General Assembly prepares to meet starting this afternoon. We pray especially for our elder, Ann Foreman, as she serves as a commissioner this week, that she would see your Spirit at work through this court of your church, and that all the decisions made by the commissioners would be made with compassion, justice, and grace. As we rise now from your table and go out into this new week, guide us with your Spirit. Make us open to the prompting of your winds and flames of change, so that we can be your church in this changing world. And we pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Our closing hymn this morning is We Are One in the Spirit. And the version that we're going to see on our screens and that we can sing along with comes from the folk group online choir of St. Teresa's Parish Church. And they're housed in Beaconsfield, England. Isn't this the wonder of this beautiful day, this time that we live in, that we can be led in our singing this morning by the folk group online choir from England? So we'll remain seated as we sing together. Now into God's world, filled with a spark of the Holy Spirit. Be open to the winds of renewal and the flames of passion that are not confined to this space, but reside within each one of us, allowing us to be the church beyond these walls, allowing us to make God's Spirit visible wherever we may be. Go now in faith, go in peace, and go in love. Amen.